Hi, I'm Pure Excellence, the most important political mind this side of the United States. But let's just explore this idea. I'm gonna pass it to my homeboy, James. James, go ahead and take this away.
Two, the Stimulus Lighthouse Alert Community presents, Trump can't use the Supreme Court to cheat in overtime if he loses in regulation. Can he? The Supreme Court opening produced by Ruth Bader Ginsburg's death has put the prospective legal concerns surrounding November's election into what newspaper writers like to call sharp relief. With Ginsburg gone, there will be at the majority of four justices Elena Kagan, Sonia Sotomayor, Stephen Breyer, and potentially the legitimacy-minded Chief Justice John Roberts who can be relied on to turn down whatever honestly partisan efforts the Trump campaign might make to revoke Democratic tallies in swing states. These challenges would be made in lower courts but get kicked rapidly up to the Supremes. Such legal battles are apparently at the core of the president's re-election method. He trails Joe Biden by a wide margin in nationwide polling and by narrower, however steady, margins in the majority of the key battlefield states. If Trump is going to recreate his 2016 map, it will imply putting together a string of resurgence victories that turn on small distinctions in the statewide vote counts. It is those vote counts that his re-election project is currently prosecuting in lower courts which he, in recent days, has begun to make ominous noises about requiring a Supreme Court justice to help him tinker. In his characteristic way of stating the blunt reality in a manner that would be admirable if not for all of the remainder of the things he does, Trump said on Monday, relating to the court opening, that we should act rapidly because we're gone nah half, probably, election things involved here, you understand, because of the fake ballots that they'll be sending. By which he suggested, real mail-in ballots. On Tuesday, he stated that with the unsolicited countless ballots that they're sending, you're gone nah need nine justices. On Wednesday, he addressed a press reporter who asked if he'd dedicate to a tranquil shift of power thus, get rid of the tallies, and you'll have a very we'll have a really serene there will not be a transfer, frankly. There'll be an extension. Trump, in his own words, needs a fully filled Supreme Court that will eliminate the ballots he wishes to eliminate. There is excellent reason to believe he will, a minimum of, have an amenable court. In 2000's Bush v. Gore, a conservative-leaning Supreme Court halted vote counting in Florida in order to set up a Republican president. Recently, an even more conservative court has enabled the Trump administration to disregard congressional subpoenas, divert congressional appropriations to spend for border wall building and construction that Congress refused to money, and carry out a foreign visitor restriction that was explicitly motivated by religious discrimination. One does not have great self-confidence that this group, if Ginsburg is replaced with one more conservative ideologue, will stand up for small d democratic principles if those concepts might lead directly to the inauguration of a big d democratic president. Even if Republicans don't be successful in setting up a replacement by November, a court split 4-4 would not have the votes to overturn suspicious pro-Trump lower court rulings by the many partisan judges who've been jammed into office given that 2016 by Trump and Mitch McConnell. The question, then is, how much damage could an all however openly partisan Supreme Court, especially in tandem with partisan Supreme Courts at the state level and partisan appeals judges, do? It's impossible to provide a single definitive answer, because that would need knowing precisely what is in Trump's brain when he makes these remarks. And nobody, including Trump himself, ever knows exactly what he implies by anything. But we can look at his remarks in the context of what his project has done, then put that in the context of what we understand about what may be taking place on the ground in November. One possibility is that, in stating that he'll require a friendly court for election things, Trump is referring to the efforts his campaign is already making to restrict the schedule of mail-in ballots and to circumscribe the variety of them that will count. In Nevada, New Jersey, and Montana, the campaign has sued, so far unsuccessfully, to stop plans to send ballots to every registered voter. In Iowa, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and somewhere else, it has filed more targeted lawsuits over how late such tallies can be accepted, whether drop boxes can be utilized to gather them, whether they can be counted if their instructions aren't followed with best precision, and other concerns. The facial claim in these suits is that Republicans are worried about the potential for large-scale fraud operations stealing countless tallies out of mailboxes, paying off mail carriers, printing and submitting phony tallies regardless of such things never having happened in any of the states that have used mail-in balloting for years. The insultingly obvious political motive to which this facade is crudely glued is that an out-of-proportion number of Democrats prepare to use mail-in ballots since they are worried about COVID-19 transmission at ballot sites and or do not have the personal versatility to vote an individual. So that's the very first prospective meaning of Trump's comments. He wishes for as lots of possible judgments that will restrict the accessibility of mail-in ballots and allow them to be disqualified once they're sent out in. As the New Yorker's Jeffrey Toobin describes, this strategy is the terrible kit of Bush v. Gore, the idea being that considering that a tiny margin in a provided state could wind up being the fulcrum on which the Electoral College pointers to the Republican, like when Florida was chosen by 537 votes in 2000, it's to the GOP's advantage to be prepared to scrap and claw for as lots of ballots to be discarded as possible. Biden has won. The issue for this method, at this moment, is that Trump is predicted to lose to Joe Biden by broad adequate margins that even the largest varieties of possible disqualifications that are being tossed around would not be enough. If current forecasts are appropriate is a big if, yes, remember the needle, blah blah, sorry, I'm burning out of having to talk about the president's electoral prospects as if he has ancient, eldritch powers that go beyond the guidelines of probability. One local analyst approximates 100,000 mail-in ballots might be disqualified in Florida, a Republican-run state that currently runs under ideal conditions for the Trump project. However, 538's finest guess is that, even with recent tightening, Biden needs to win there by 140,000 votes. And as a helpful New York Times page notes, just 47% of the mail-in ballots that have been requested in the state were asked for by registered Democrats. Even if a significant piece of the independent voters who asked for mail-in tallies are Biden supporters, it would take more than 100,000 disqualifications to slash off adequate net Biden choose Trump to win. In Pennsylvania, there have actually also been cautions of a 100,000 ballot disqualification, but the 538 margin equates to approximately a 250,000 vote Biden win. In Wisconsin, the projected Biden margin of success is 180,000, and while there is a legal conflict over the length of time mail-in tallies will be counted for, a recent analysis by the Democratic information firm Target Smart concluded that Republicans and Democrats have been asking for absentee tallies in the state at roughly the same rate, which means disqualifications would not necessarily assist Trump. The analysis discovered approximately the exact same even partisan split in Michigan, so unless the race tightens up, the scrap and claw effort will not suffice. Perhaps that's not what he indicates, then. Trump also said over the weekend that the reason he desires a new justice rapidly is so that the federal court system can make sure that a winner is explained on the night of November 3rd instead of after a prolonged period of ballot counting. A brand new Atlantic article says that, according to Republican sources, the project may press Republican-held state legislatures in states with high mail-in rates to overturn the results of their state's elections, i.e., ordering their Electoral College electors to elect Trump rather of Biden on the premises that mail-in ballots are basically all deceitful and that whatever votes can be found in by midnight or 2 on November 3rd are the only real votes. This would be a chaotic circumstance, but possibly the Supreme Court would become involved at some point and give its imprimatur. It makes good sense that Trump would like the concept that the television show called Election Night ought to be the true authority on who wins the presidency, however he may wish to beware what he wants. Once again, he runs up against the problem of the surveys. Trump is presently predicted to lose statewide votes in Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin by no less than 4 points. In Arizona, it's 3 points. In Florida and North Carolina, the margins are smaller but still presently favor Biden. What, then, will lead to those states appear like in the hours after surveys close? In Michigan/Pennsylvania/Wisconsin, administrators are presently prevented by law from processing mailed-in ballots before Election Day. However, in large part since of the panic over the capacity for delayed election results, the Democratic govs and election commissioners and regional officials in those states are preparing in a variety of ways to count votes as fast as possible even under this year's uncommon circumstances. The chair of the election board in Pennsylvania's Bucks County says he is aiming for completion of the week of the election. Michigan's Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson offered a current interview in which she explained not finishing until completion of the week as the worst-case scenario she is trying to prevent. Arizona, Florida, and North Carolina, on the other hand, allow administrators to start processing absentee tallies well in advance of Election Day. So there are states in which Biden has narrow ballot leads that ought to be able to report outcomes without delay. There are locations that he has broad leads that might be counting more slowly, however not we won't know for a month slowly. State-by-state results, moreover, are correlated in such a way that a Biden win in Florida likely implies one in Pennsylvania. The networks comprehend this, even Fox, which has a genuine decision desk, which means its election night calls are produced, like its polls, by professionals instead of partisan characters. Even if New York and California are sluggish counting mail-in ballots and their combined Democratic federal governments do not do anything to speed things up despite the attention presently being paid to the issue, there are other big states like Georgia, Illinois, New Jersey, Texas, and Virginia that do pre-processing and ought to be reporting at something like a normal rate. Unless Tucker Carlson and Sean Hannity seize the means of producing Fox's calls, then or backstage pressure from the White House encourages network executives to muzzle their actual professionals, all the television individuals theorizing the offered numbers on election night and the following few days will be describing, if current forecasts hold, a comfy Biden win, one that will involve a nationwide popular vote margin of well over 5 million and can be anticipated with confidence as quickly as Florida and Arizona are ended up reporting. Pennsylvania is the state in which Trump is more than likely to wind up having the opportunity to make a case for overturning results, given its GOP-held legislature and the info that's currently offered about partisan mail-in request variation and vote counting speed. However, for that to be possibly useful for him, polls would have to tighten to the point that the state suggestions the Electoral College. Our Trump-traumatized brains need a break. We won't get one. A photographer who covered 5 years of Trump rallies on one of the most disturbing thing he saw. She worked to turn Georgia blue and got arrested for it. Once again. What damage will Trump do on his way out? The surveys may change, and with no state ever having held a presidential election during a pandemic before, it would be careless to forecast when we will certainly know anything. However, Trump's vision of using the Supreme Court to protect what seems on election night like a repeat MAGA win is, according to what we know today, a long shot. One never ever wishes to dismiss any situation with Trump like one in which, state, he has actually comfortably lost the nationwide popular vote. An electoral college, however, tries to persuade lawmakers in Arizona, Florida, and Pennsylvania that every mail-in vote in their state should be neglected, but that would still be a much heavier lift, in regards to viewed authenticity and the perspective to provoke national discontent, than anything he or his celebration has actually yet tried. This scenario is pre-election, however now, by the time you are reading this, Biden won. With a caution that everybody must try, as difficult as they can, to fill tallies out properly and count them immediately, we are not presently, as far as anybody knows, on a direct course towards the United States' first ever breakdown in the continuity of government. However, it's true that it would only take a shift of a couple of points in the nationwide polls, or a mistake in the surveys by a couple of points, like in 2016, to bring one about. Which is most likely something we must all talk about if and when the next non-Trump president is inaugurated. This scenario is pre-election, however now, by the time you are reading this, Biden won.